was just like someone was just pouring a bucket of water down on Houston. These raindrops were just the biggest, fattest raindrops I had ever seen.
The water was just, it was coming from everywhere at one point, coming across the street, down the street, and we were just trapped.
When you see an 18-wheeler in a parking lot completely submerged except for the very top of the box, you know the water's pretty deep.
The scale of the disaster.
Oh, my baby's in this boat now!
The number of people who needed help was completely overwhelming.
From the Weather Channel, this is Storm Stories with meteorologist Jim Cantore.
Tuesday, June 5th, 2001. Tropical storm Allison makes landfall near Galveston, Texas, after forming off the coast 7 hours earlier. It packs winds of 45 miles per hour and dumps up to 8 inches of rain. Within a day, the storm is downgraded to a tropical depression and appears to be leaving the area. But the remnants of Allison surprise residents.
People thought the storm had weakened and gone north and wasn't coming back. It turned back to the south and moved back over Houston.
When Allison returns that Friday, Houston, known as the Bayou City, is unprepared. Houston is the country's fourth largest city, with 2 million downtown residents and 4.5 million in the metropolitan region. The sprawling city is extremely flat, with an elevation only slightly above sea level. Moisture must be absorbed by an intricate system of bayous and man-made canals. The drains are already at capacity when Allison comes back for a second round.
The National Weather Service here in Houston began to issue flood watches, and these were of a very serious nature. They knew that if this thing came back and dumped a lot of rain, it was going to be dumping on saturated ground and we could flood very quickly.
Few people are ready, however, for the massive amount of rain that begins falling around 5 p.m.
Even though Allison was weak over land, it produced a lot of rain because it moved so slowly.
We have a very good system of bayous and creeks, but it can be overwhelmed with rainfall rates above 3 inches an hour, and that's what we were getting. Really, I was getting a sinking feeling in my stomach, to tell you the truth.
Three miles north of downtown, about one block from White Oak Bayou, 21-year-old Chad Guerin is relaxing at home. He's joined early in the evening by Jeremy Harmon and Mark McDavid, two friends he met at Texas A&M University.
It was raining pretty decently when I drove over there, enough to where I had to drive slow, but there was no floodwaters anywhere.
Around 10 p.m., the rain grows even worse.
It just unleashed and was pouring. It didn't stop all night. It just kept pouring and pouring.
Even so, the three friends have tickets to see a local concert that's just 10 minutes away. They decide to go ahead with their plans.
I guess we figured the least that could happen is we'd maybe stall out. That's about, you know, the extent of what we thought could go wrong that night.
So we got in his truck and proceeded to try to cross the water. We got about halfway through. It came up to about the bottom of his doors, and his truck stalled.
The three young men realize they've made a serious mistake. Water from the bayou gushes inside the truck. Within seconds, the vehicle begins to float away.
The current started to sweep the car, basically right out from under us, and we were just starting to drift over the embankment. And that's when we decided that we all needed to jump out of the car and hopefully get to safety.
The three friends managed to squeeze their way through the roll-down windows, but their ordeal is far from over. Chad, Jeremy, and Mark find themselves in debris-filled water that's nearly 40 feet deep in some places. The current is so powerful that it sweeps them into nearby trees. They hang on for their lives.
I was scared. I was definitely scared. I had never been in a situation like that in my entire life, and I think it was the first time that I ever had to sit there and, you know, take a second and make my peace that, you know, I might not get out of that water.
There were some people on the other side of the water. They started yelling to us, But with the rain coming down and with the currents, we couldn't really hear what they were saying. So we were yelling back for them to call help.
Police officers C.R. Bean and Michael Lumpkin are less than a mile away when they get the alarm.
A call went out over the radio that there were people in the White Oak Bio who were screaming for help, possibly drowning.
The roads are so flooded that it takes the officers almost a half hour to cover six blocks. When they finally arrive, they are shocked at what they see. What was a street is now a raging river.
The rain was coming down nonstop. It was cold. The wind was blowing hard, and you could see the current in the water, how fast it was moving.
When we initially got here, we couldn't see the kids in the trees, but we could hear them.
The officers figure out where the young men are and drag themselves through the raging water. The only object they can hold on to is some barbed wire that tops a nearby fence. They reach 23-year-old Jeremy first. Sergeant Bean throws a life jacket attached to a rope. After a few tries, Jeremy finally grabs it.
You know, once I had it on, I just jumped in the water and hoped for the best and kind of turned my back towards them and just tried to kick with them, and, you know, they just pulled me to shore.
The officers then spot Chad and Mark, who are clinging to the same tree. Chad insists that Mark be rescued next. A few minutes later, the lifeline is within Mark's reach.
All I could see was just Mark's head and the orange life preserver sitting out in the water, and it would just thunder and lightning and go dark, and it was just raining, the sirens. It was all just kind of running together and really surreal.
The officers pull Mark in. Two of the three friends are safe now, but the downpour is getting worse. The rescue team struggles to reach Chad, who's been in the chilly water for almost 2 hours.
We were close to hypothermic. Just being in the water, and I had over 100 amp bites on my body.
Finally, the officers reach him. But moments later, things go tragically wrong.
As the torrential waters from Tropical Storm Allison continue to rise, so does the level of panic for Houston residents. And that spells disaster for Chad and many others. That's next when Storm Stories continues.
It's around 1 a.m. on Saturday, June 9th, 2001. Remnants of Tropical Storm Allison are stationary over Houston, pounding it with, at times, up to 5 inches of rain an hour. Mark McDavid and Jeremy Harmon have just been rescued by police after clinging to trees for almost 2 hours in the raging waters. But their friend, 21-year-old Chad Guerin, is still trapped.
All we could do is sit there and watch and, you know, just kind of to yell for Chad to hang on and, you know, do the best that he could.
The officers make their way to within reaching distance of Chad, but he starts to panic and the rescue goes wrong.
He started struggling. He said his foot was caught on something. One of the officers reached out and grabbed his hand, but when he did, it pulled the officer in the water. So I grabbed him and pulled him back. And when we did that, their hands separated.
The moment their hands are pulled apart, Chad goes under. He's at the mercy of the rushing current.
Jeremy and I just started yelling for him to keep fighting and keep swimming. And then he went under again, and then we didn't see him.
I saw Chad go underwater, and I saw them kind of all turn, kind of with their heads hung, kind of walking out of the water, just kind of shaking their heads. And I kind of knew at that point that it was over. I mean, my friend was gone.
By now, it's close to 2 a.m. and the flood is ravaging much of the city. Near downtown Houston, 36-year-old Demetrius Bradley arrives for his early morning shift at the Methodist Hospital. He heads toward the basement, unaware that it's rapidly filling with water.
The elevator popped open, I jumped on it and pushed down, and it went down. and it hit water. And the water started filling up the elevator.
Demetrius is trapped between floors. He frantically looks for a way to escape, but there is none. He calls out for help. Then he begins to pray.
I told Lord, please, Lord, I know you didn't let me make it all the way here just to die in this elevator. I know you didn't. I know you got something planned special for me, and this night is it.
Minutes later, hospital dispatcher Jesse Wilhite takes an urgent call. A man can be heard screaming in the elevator and is in danger of drowning.
A 4x6 box in dark with water coming up on you, that's got to be horrible. So there was really no thinking about it after the initial shock or panic, and it was just move fast.
Jesse needs keys to get into the elevator, but they're kept in the basement.
Well, I thought I could go down there and maybe just waist deep water, go in there and get the key for the elevator. There was no way. The water was, it was like having a river jamming underneath your feet.
Inside the elevator, water is swirling up to Demetrius's chest. Time is running out.
I was just thinking about if I was a path, what would my son think? And what would my mother and my brother and them think?
Back on the hospital's main floor, Jesse finally finds a backup key. He races down the hall to the elevator door, where security officer George Ross is waiting.
Jesse took the key, stuck it in a little elevator hole, and he turned, kept turning, and finally the doors kind of gave, it broke a little. And then we put our fingers in it and pulled it open.
The two men enter the shaft and carefully climb on top of the elevator car. Jesse rips open the hatch.
I'll never forget looking down in there and seeing his face, just in what little bit of light there was. There was panic. George got on one side, I got on the other, and we pulled the young man up.
When I got out, I felt very lucky. Very lucky. So I got on the ground and I said my prayers.
It's now early Saturday morning, and Allison is setting new records for flood damage all over Houston.
By that time, a lot of the creeks and the bayous were getting to their 100-year flood, and many of them getting up to their 500-year flood, and some even above that. The rainfall rates were incredible. Here at the station, we recorded almost 7 inches of rain falling in 1 hour's time.
Thousands of people are homeless. Thousands more need to be rescued. Bob Stolting, helicopter pilot for the local CBS affiliate, can't believe his eyes.
I've lived here in Texas since 1968. I've been flying around the city since 1982, and I have never seen anything to the magnitude that this was. As the day progressed, and every time we thought that we couldn't see anything worse, the further east we got and the further northeast we got, which is where they got the brunt of the storm, every time we'd hit another neighborhood, we'd see conditions worse than even we'd seen before.
The Coast Guard has its hands full. Commander Matt Sisson and rescue swimmer Chris Monville are some of the first up.
We lifted off and we decided just to go to the area of Houston that had been hardest hit. For no other reason than that we figured that's where the people needed the most help.
There was people on tops of cars where all you could see was the roof of the car, no windows. There was people kind of wading through the middle of the street, you know, waist deep, chest deep.
At around 2 p.m., a woman reports that water is pouring into her brother's home near Greens Bayou in the northeast part of the city. Her brother is a 30-year-old quadriplegic who breathes with a ventilator. His house is losing power from the flooding. Without electricity, he won't survive.
With the water rising and the patient being on a ventilator, obviously needing electricity, we had some serious concerns about this patient's welfare.
By the time the crew reaches the quadriplegic's neighborhood, the water outside the house is 5 feet high. Unfortunately, the rescue team is having trouble finding the right house.
In an urban setting like that, you know, there's a lot more obstacles to deal with.
You've got a lot of trees in the vicinity, and we also had power lines that we had to deal with.
Even more confusing are the large numbers of people waving for help.
And so the biggest thing, problem we had was figure out who was really in need and who was just hanging out in their house.
The crew searches frantically as the waters continue to rise. June 9th, 2001, Houston. A Coast Guard crew is desperately searching for a quadriplegic who is trapped in the floodwaters of Tropical Storm Allison. Rescue swimmer Chris Monville is lowered into 4 feet of water. A neighbor points him in the right direction. Chris wades into the quadriplegic's house.
I found the gentleman laying in his bed on an electrically powered ventilator, and his room was set up, you know, like a hospital. Well, we have what we call a bag valve mask. We just basically squeeze the bag and pump oxygen to somebody manually, and that's what we had to do once we took him off the ventilator.
The man is moved outside via a large rescue basket known as a litter. Neighbors lend a fishing boat to float the patient toward the hovering helicopter. The helicopter can hoist about 600 pounds. That limit is about to be tested.
The combination of the rescue swimmer, the litter, and the patient probably came to right around 550 pounds.
I had to come up with him and breathe for him because we couldn't stop breathing for him once he came off the respirator.
While Chris dangles off the side of the litter, the pair is slowly lifted to the chopper. Chris never leaves the man's side, continually pumping air into his lungs.
You know, he looked at me and I looked at him. He couldn't tell me how he's feeling or anything, but I think that he understood that we were doing the best we could do for him, and we were taking him out of that situation and taking him somewhere better.
The helicopter flies the patient to an ambulance, which quickly drives him to a nearby hospital. Acts of heroism are the norm in Houston that weekend. On Sunday morning, resident Bruce Reisner cruises the swollen bayous in his flat-bottom boat looking for people to help. At around 9 a.m., he spots a National Guard truck sinking in 10 feet of water. Several people are trapped in the back.
I pulled around to the back of the National Guard truck and I hollered, "I want the babies! I want the babies now!"
Bruce loads the children into his boat, then the adults. He shuttles them all to safety. Bruce will spend 28 straight hours away from home. During that time, he'll help save about 500 people. By late Sunday afternoon, much of the water has receded. Over the next few days, homeowners who had been forced to evacuate begin to trickle back and assess the damage. 57-year-old Jody Walter is shocked at what he finds.
I just didn't really know what to expect. We had to pry open the door to get in. Just hard to describe. It's to see everything that you have just totally destroyed.
My daughter's picture. I'm away. 2 weeks ago. In the ceiling.
More than 45,000 homes and businesses have been flooded. In a 36-hour period, the Coast Guard performed 220 rescues in the Houston area. But not everyone made it out of Allison's grasp. 22 people lost their lives, including 21-year-old Chad Guerin. His friends, Jeremy and Mark, will never forget how much he meant to them. They also won't soon forget the unexpected force of Allison.
I think it just shows us there are powers out there beyond our control and that things don't always work out the way they're supposed to be.
I never did think that a flood would be that dangerous. but it really gives me perspective on just the power of nature, seeing something like this sweep in and then be gone so quickly as well.
So exactly how much damage did Tropical Storm Allison cause in the Houston area? You may be surprised at the answer. That's next, when Storm Stories returns. So how much damage did Tropical Storm Allison cause? The price tag in the Houston area alone was a whopping $5 billion. Most of the damage occurred after Allison was no longer a tropical storm. Total rainfall amounts across the Houston metro area were astonishing. Nearly 40 inches fell in one location. For Storm Stories, I'm meteorologist Jim Cantore. Your local forecast is next.
This is the worst storm in the